Okay, so I'll operate from here. Thanks for having me. So I think first I would like to start with a bit of an introduction of Bangladesh. That would be easier to understand where I come from and my place and everything. So this is actually, since we don't have a laser pointer, I'll just move the mouse so that you get an idea what I'm trying to show you. This here is the Himalayan range, this bit. And from the Himalaya comes out major rivers. One is Brahmaputra, which is this one, coming through here. And the other one is Ganges, which is flowing from here and then getting in here. And there are some other rivers coming from these edges. So this is basically a very low land where all the rivers from different edges are coming together. And then through this comes to the Bay of Bengal. This is Bay of Bengal, and the Bay of Bengal goes into the Indian Ocean. So this is what my country looks like. It's a delta. And, you know, the rivers have been flowing for so many thousands of years, accumulating silt. And with the silt, this very flat land has been created. So this is one of the largest, I mean, in fact, the largest delta in the world. So you see, since it's a delta and it's such a soft, silty soil, that the as the rivers reshapes themselves, the edges of the water bodies are always constantly eroding. So as the land erodes, it could be a house, it could be a township. So that always happens, that it constantly shifts and these things sort of erodes away. And then again, in some places, you see some more land emerging. So it's a very fluid landscape where you see land erosion and emergences. And that's how people have been living in this country for so many thousands of years. And we are a country of 140 million people. And river is one of the major sources of fishery, and also our very fertile soil, which is farming is also one of the major ways of living. People are very close to nature and very simple in their lifestyles. If you see, we have mud houses built out of mud, and very basic, minimal lifestyle that people generally live with. And we have a history that goes back 2,500 years. We have Buddhist monasteries from that time on. And since we are just basically a silt, mud-based land, our major building material has always been brick. So we take mud, we turn it into brick, baked bricks, and then this has been constructed since thousands of years. So if you go to Bangladesh, you encounter many of these kind of temples where you see terracotta works, mythologies of Hindu myths, or even during the Muslim times, there are many nicely decorated mosques even, where you see terracotta, burnt terracottas all over the buildings. This is where our language comes from. So this is also around 2,000 years old. This is the script from where our language, what we speak in, Bangla, comes from. So first, the project that Peter just mentioned, the museum. I will just give a bit of background of the history of the country's birth and the project that relates to that. So if you take a look at these two maps, the red one actually shows, it shows the demography of the population of the Indian subcontinent in 1909. And the red one shows the density of Hindu population, and the green one shows the density of Muslim population at that time in 1909, done by the British, because we were a British colony at that time. And based on this, when British decided to leave the Indian subcontinent, the subcontinent got divided into three parts. And the three parts are basically, if you see, this is very dense green, is a Muslim area. And also this part, which is very densely green, is a Muslim area. And the rest of it is, this part, is Hindu population. So the Hindu area became India, and the dark two green patches became Pakistan. So that was East Pakistan, This part was East Pakistan and this was West Pakistan. And this West Pakistan later on became Bangladesh. So when this Pakistan happened, it was in 1947, and there was a distance of almost 2,000 miles and a country. It's an impossible country, you can understand, that it's 2,000 miles of distance between them, and with the Indian land in between, we had a country which we had, except for the religion, we had nothing in common. We did not speak the same language, we had no cultural similarity, nothing whatsoever. So it was always a constant friction between the two places and the people. And at the end, this is the image of showing you the division of India and Pakistan, which was done in like 2 weeks' time. A British barrister was flown in, named Mr. Redcliffe, who did the partitioning without really understanding the borders of the places and who lived where. And it's one of the largest forced mass migration in the history of mankind. And well, this is something I show because that sort of gives me shows you the origin where I come from. So as the whole subcontinent got divided, Bengal by itself got divided as well. So this was the original map of Bengal, as you see. And Bangladesh was carved out of it like this. So, and my family actually comes from this little pocket here, which went to Indian part. So we had to shift our residence from this little pocket to this place here in Dhaka. And, you know, if this wonderful Mr. Redcliffe would have drawn the line just straight like that, we wouldn't have to come all the way. And this is actually a very prized possession, which we kept. This is the only thing we have, actually, of a reminder of our route that was from here. So, as I said, that from 47 onwards till 1970, it has been a long struggle of fights and revolutions. In 1952, there was a declaration that Urdu, which is spoken by the Pakistanis, would become our language, official language. And then, of course, the Bengalis did not want that, so there was a huge fight. And 21st of February, which is actually declared as the Mother Tongue Day, is due to the revolution that happened in Bengal for the movement that, no, we want to speak in Bangla, not in Urdu. So that's why that day, I don't know if you know, but 21st of February, according to our revolution for the language, is declared as a Mother Tongue Day. So this was a struggle at the end in 1971. This ended with a lot of chaos. This little child, as you see this image, you see that how with a lot of energy this revolution took place. And this boy was killed right after this image was taken. And this is our leader at that time, Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, whom we know as our father of the nation. And he made a pledge on the 7th of March, 1971, that we don't want to stay with Pakistan anymore. We want a free Bangladesh. And that was the pledge that took place in this image that you see. And this is the site where my museum was later on built. So we ended up in a war, which was a 9-month-long, really intense war. And you see, this started on the 25th of March when the army went on a rampage of killing people at the middle of the night. And this middle image shows intellectuals being sought out and killed. You see that their hands are tied at the back in the brick field. And this image is a lady. She was an editor of a magazine, also killed. So there was a lot of brutal intellectual killing that took place. But later on, and after 9-month-long war, the country got its freedom, and we were free Bangladesh from December onwards. And after 26 years after our independence, a competition was called for the independence monument, or the monument for freedom, and a museum that would commemorate our this war and the struggle for the freedom that took place. And this is our city, as you see here, very densely populated city of Dhaka, which is now inhabited by 20 million people. So I suppose you have no idea of how many people that is. Like Peter always says that when I'm, and I do actually feel that way, when I come out of Dhaka, go to any place on earth, I think, what happened to all the people? Where did the people go? Is it some kind of a strike or what happened, you know? Yeah, so that's actually how it is. It's densely populated place. And this is the site, actually, where you see. This is the ground which was given to us, because this is the historic ground where that image that I showed you, that big event took place, where we took the pledge of becoming independent. And this is also the place where the Pakistani army surrendered at the end. So it's a very historic place to place the museum. But as you see that this is so densely built, this is perhaps one of the last patches of green areas that is left in the city for people to come to and enjoy. So that was quite of a dilemma for us, that how do you deal with this thing, like when you have a museum. And it was quite an intense program of having a museum, a research center, a library, and all these different functions that needed to be incorporated in the building. And which means that you have to build a lot of built areas. And we didn't think that would be really right, because you're taking away green from the people who actually doesn't have much of green. And this is the city of Dhaka. You can see the density of with which the buildings are made. You can hardly see a tree, and it's intensely built. So at the end, we came up with an idea that we should take the minimum of space that is required for the museum, that we keep an absolutely minimal footprint, and we do not take the park, but we turn that building into a kind of a plaza where people can just enjoy and celebrate. And so this is the only space we took. This is our building, which is the museum. So if we look at the master plan, we just created a road that links them together. And this is an already existing children's park. And we created this plaza here where people can come and enjoy. And we have some elements on the plaza that are commemorating and of all the events that took place. And we made an elliptical walkway where you can walk around, and we had the tower on the plaza, which you can see from different distances and enjoy the thing. And we just added an amphitheater to it. So that's the three-dimensional image that you see. So the plaza is not really very high. It's only 5 feet high. So your eye do not really get blocked. You can see the whole space altogether. And you walk up the plaza, and we basically thought of this as a journey. And the idea was that, you know, this independence that we are celebrating is not an independence that was won just by itself, as I showed you that it was an intense war and struggle that went through. So, you know, freedom, dream, aspiration, these things have a certain direction which goes upwards, and we try to relate them to infinite. But then again, when you think of sadness or memories, you know, things that are really much more darker, that always needs to be embedded into the heart of Earth. So that's what the idea came up, that it's a kind of a paradox that really we needed to deal with this duality of having a celebration of the independence, at the same time remembering what we have lost. So that also kind of gave us this whole concept of taking the museum underground. So we placed the underground below grade, and the plaza, which became the celebration, space for celebration, and we have the tower on top of it as a mark of our independence and the celebration. This is what you see. I mean, if I just separate the things, this is a wall which takes you down into the museum, also gives the strength of the people's intent towards freedom. And as you walk up, there is a small tower here which commemorates that 7th March speech. And then there is a circular water body in the center. And this water is actually depicting this 9-month war, long war. And there's a circular hole in the middle, if you see here. That hole actually takes in all the water receding into that little hole, that dark little hole that is in the middle. And at the end is the tower. Am I going back? Yes. Okay. So that's our, if I take you through again, this is the journey. This is the 7 March speech. This is my central water body. That's the tower here. And you go through this into the museum. That's pretty much now what you see. You see, this is the center. And that's our tower. That's the wall. So if you go into the museum, this is a model to show you. You go down with the ramp. And on the first level is an audiovisual room. And then from the audiovisual room, where you get to see a small film on the whole event. And then after that, you go down the ramp to almost 24 feet below grade. We are on feet, sorry about that. But 24 feet below grade. And that's where the museum is located. So the museum is basically two sides, and then there is a dark wall which connects to the both sides. And as you go from the black edge, you go enter into the central space in the middle. So I'll just take you through the spaces. As Peter mentioned, that it took us 16 years to complete the project. That's because, you know, when we won the project in 1997, we just graduated, just like you probably will in a few years' time. So I was just like 2 years after my graduation when this competition was. It was a national competition, it was an open competition. There was no bar about having a membership and whatnot. So we submitted and we won. And well, winning is one thing, you get very happy, yay. But the thing is, you have to build the thing. It's not such a simple issue. You're building a museum which is going to commemorate the history of your land, at the same time a tower that will be there for hundreds of years. So at the end, it became really a task that was so responsible. I mean, it has to be a really big responsibility. So we went through a lot of a lot of very difficult times and designing, contemplating what it should be. And we looked into the idea of timelessness in architecture, because timelessness is something that that will probably is necessary for this project. We did not want any kind of signature as such that will give it a sense of time, but it should just move on. And for that reason, if you know, I'm sure you all know, that we have one of the finest examples of timeless architecture, which is our Parliament building, designed by Louis Kahn. So that building became a sort of a place to learn as an architect, how do you capture those elements of timelessness. And light is a major element, geometry is an element. So these things we tried to bring together and create the spaces. So as you go down, this is you come down the steps. This project, as I said, took us 16 years to finish, but it's not yet finished because we are still implementing the display area, so you won't be seeing any displays inside. It's just still a void space. And I think the void was quite nice, in fact. I mean, I don't know. It was quite an interesting space. So this is the dark area where you have all the images of genocide and killing. And then you enter into the central circular space, which is actually a very contemplative space. You enter there and there is no display inside. It's just a very solemn, dark area where only the source of light is coming through that central hole in the middle. And you see the water that was up there in the plaza receding into the central space. And the sound of the water is something we intended, that it's kind of remembering the people we have lost. It's a monument, or you can say memorial to the lost people of the war. And then you go again to the next part of the museum area. And we've tried to take in daylight so that, you know, even though we are 24 feet below grade, we don't feel that it's not so low down. So we were kind of really worried about that. So we tried to bring in daylight as much as possible from all sources. So as you go up, you face the tower. The tower, which is actually the Tower of Independence. It's a 140 feet high tower. And the idea was that it's a tower of freedom, independence. So how do you actually express freedom or independence? Freedom is something, you know, that is a right of every human being who's born in this earth, that everybody is free. And this tower of freedom is not just only for the Bengalis who fought, but it's for everyone. We thought of it as a very universal feeling that you pass on from one generation to the other. So it had to be a tower which depicts this idea of freedom. And we thought that the best way of interpreting freedom is through light. So we took light as our design element. And how do you take light as an element? So then we went for glass. The glass is our actual element, which will hold light during the day or even in the night. So if you take a look at this section, what we have is a space frame structure in the middle that takes the overall load of the whole 150 feet high column. And this is glass stacked. If you see this edge here, glasses are all stacked one top of the other, which is about 6 inches thick, and 25 millimeter thick glasses stacked and created a panel, and this panel is clad onto the space frame structure. This is what it looks like. So these are glass, thick glasses, stacked and fixed to the wall. So during the day, the light actually travels through that material of glass, kind of giving it a very prismatic effect. And if it's a nice light, you can see the colors of different rainbow colors through that. And so that's what you see. And in the night, it's lit from the outside. And the material of the glass is absolutely, you know, takes in the light and it pushes it upward. So you get a glowing light tower. These are not 3D rendered images. These are real images, by the way. So this is, you see at night how it's lit. And we have 4 xenon lights on 4 sides, which actually shoots the beam upward. So you see when people are there, they're sort of sitting around enjoying. And this is supposed to be a reflecting pool, a water body, which the water is not there yet. It's only stone, you see. And this is the 16th of December. You can see the amount of people there that is gathered. 16th of December is our victory day when the war ended. So on that day, there is a huge amount of people gathering for different kind of celebrations. This is during the evening time. And this is what you see in the night sky if you go to Dhaka. So now I will show you another project which is completely out of Dhaka, much more in a nice, wonderful setting. Once you move out of Dhaka, it's a very different scenario. The thing is, Bangladesh has a very weird system of having everything centralized to the city, that for whatever reason, all the people have to come to the city. So the city is really dense and crowded. But once you move out of the city, it's a much nicer place. So I'll take you to the place which is more to the south, southeast part of Bangladesh. This place, this is actually our mangrove forest. It's a very beautiful mangrove forest, and in fact one of the, I think one of the rarest forests, which is quite endangered because of the climatic issues. Our salt water is moving and receding into the sweet water system, and that's why this forest is sort of getting endangered nowadays, because we will lose the mangrove in that effect. And this is home to the Royal Bengal Tigers. And my site is located somewhere close to here, this year. And this is supposed to be a resort. And I'll show you images of the place, but let's take a look at the overall site scenario. You see that it's all farmland. It's all, there's all green area. It's all paddy fields and different kind of farming, and all of Bangladesh is fed by the vegetables and the crops that are grown here in this area. So this is the site location, this area here. And these are all the spread out villages all around this area. So from the tip of the site, this is the view you get, which is quite a nice place actually to be. And this is what you see around the countryside, around my site where the project is located. This is during the winter when we have mustard fields, and you see yellow mustard fields, date palm trees. And this is still a village scene in Bangladesh, where you see cow carts and cycles and not really cars moving anymore. So when I went to the site, and in fact, I chose the site. I was given the privilege of choosing the site because the client just had the program and they wanted to build a resort, and we were looking at, for a site in that location. So, and my client is an American lady, so every time she would go to the site, the prices would go very high up. So I had to go and choose the site actually, to go and find out which part of the land we needed and wanted. So finally I chose the site, and because it's a beautiful place, and we wanted to give the very Bangladeshi authentic experience to the people, and it was designed to be a very eco-friendly resort. So when I was there and I've seen the surroundings and everything, and then we were kind of in a dilemma, like how do we approach this project, because you're bringing in, flying in people from all over the place, you're bringing in city people, affluent Bangladeshis to the place, and actually the dynamics of the place is something completely different. It's very normal, very down to earth, very much in tune with the nature kind of people who are living their life with absolute basic what is needed, actually optimum lifestyle. So how do you bring them together? It's kind of really difficult a situation for us to deal with, and we thought that the intervention, it is an intervention, right? When you bring something and you put there on a site, it had to be really, really minimal. That we should do something which does not affect in a negative way this overall dynamics of the place that already exists. So we decided to go for a overall research of the place, how the buildings are built, you know, to take an idea of the vernaculars, so that we don't put a building there, but we try to incorporate the vernacular lifestyle and the ideas there. So if you see, this is what it looks like. You see, it's such a flat land, Bangladesh, that when you want to build something, we cut a water body, and you see that there are lots of smaller water bodies around here. So you cut dig a water body, and then you take the soil, you make the ground high, make a higher plinth, and that's where you put your houses. And that's how it has been done for ages, because then you create a certain contour on the site. Like here you have so much of ups and downs, we have nothing, we have absolute flat land. So that bit of contour needs to be created to get the water off the land, because we have a very high monsoon. So if you see, this is a pond, the land was raised and all the houses were created. And if you take a look at the houses here, it's basically one room. And these are just rooms clustered around a space. So if this is a space, the bedrooms are, and rooms are basically only for sleeping. It's only a space where you sleep at night. Otherwise, during the day, you spend the whole day doing whatever work that is through the day into that space, which is a courtyard, eating, sleeping, cooking, socializing, everything takes place here. Only at night you go to your room to sleep. And that has been the situation all through, because we have a climate which is very much, you know, we don't have a very high winter or a very high summer. Well, the summer these days tends to get a bit high. I mean, we get up to almost 40 degrees when I was coming back, but coming here, but it's generally something you can live as a outdoor environment. So these are the houses that you see. sections, and these are the, all the different textures that we could find in the place. So it was an extensive research, and what we found out from our research, this is an image that every child in Bangladesh draws when they're asked to draw a village. So this is our very mindset of what a village is. When I was a child, I also drew something like that. So it really doesn't exist, but this is the image of a village house to us. And the thing is, this is a roof form which is very unique to our land, which is kind of a pitch roof, but with a curved pitch. And this is known as the bungalow roof. And from the bungalow roof comes the word bungalow. And this roof has also been taken in different forms by the Mughals. If you go to any Mughal places in India, you'll see this roof. And then this was also done in concrete. So this roof is very unique to us. And this is something that is completely getting with the kind of construction technique nowadays, with the CI sheet roof, which didn't used to be there. This is completely getting away from our culture, and it's not there anymore. So we thought of reviving this thing again. So this is our master plan of the resort, where you see that we placed the restaurant, the reception areas, all at the tip of the site, which was the most beautiful and the scenic places. And we've taken all the bungalows and spread them out throughout the place. And the walkways are created. This is a completely walkway, and basically the car will be on the other edge of the property, and then there is a canal here, and the water body goes around like that. So once you are here, you can either cross across, or you can take a boat and come to the reception. And this is a place where we had the minimum energy. Once you walk through the site, we felt that there is a lack of energy. So we created these two circles, which are our retreat bungalows, we call them, which is related to the spa and the Ayurvedic treatments. So that will be placed here. And this is our rooms. So you can see that it's almost pretty much done in a way that the way our Bangladeshi lifestyle is in the villages. And this is a young man. I will tell you a story of this young boy, because I think that's important for the project, the way we approached it. He is from a potter's village, living in the locality, and he had a dream of coming to Dhaka and working in an office or some company or in a garment industry, which is quite booming in Bangladesh. So that was his dream. And when we went there, and kind of people got excited that they thought that we will make a very interesting project where it will probably turn into a city in a very short while. But our intention was completely different. We wanted to create something which is from the village. So this is the village where this boy comes from, this young man. He's from the potter's village. So pottery is their main occupation. And this is one of his elders who is making pottery. But he definitely has no interest in pottery, because pottery doesn't bring him enough money to live a good life. So he's looking towards Dhaka, to go to Dhaka and get a job. So what we did, we got in contact with him, and we said we want to create some interesting potteries, you know, keeping the shapes and whatever that you are building, you're making. So can you please help us with that? And obviously this young man had no idea about what is pottery and how it's made. It's done by his elders. So then he went back to his elders. And so we tried to create a communication between the younger generation, who's not looking towards village but looking towards city, and the people who are from the land and who has this knowledge and wisdom of that place. And we tried to create a connection between the two, and in the process get our project done. So at the end, we employed most of the villagers. All the workers that work there are from the villages around our site, and there are men, women, young, old, all kinds. So they're all working together to create this project for us, and using the local techniques. You see this is the thatching getting done, and organic farming. So we're using the villagers, and this is mud, and it's a completely mud and bamboo construction. and we've tried to bring back the roof. So basically you won't see me as an architect in this project because I'm not there. I'm more or less like an invisible architect. I did the planning, I did the master plan, I did done the houses, planned them, gave it to them, and the villagers are making it. So in a way, I always claim that I'm not really present in this project because the kind of wisdom that requires to build this place, I was not taught that. So rather, I take lesson from them through this project that I learned how things used to be done in that area. So I'll just show you some of the images. It's still under construction. So you see the mud plinth going up. It's the same material. This is all done by the local villagers. And the tree of life is one of the major elements that you see that occurs in many of our crafts. So that had been taken and put into use. So this is a very different kind of a project. So Bangladesh is basically a very tropical climate region. So Tropic of Cancer is actually passing through the center of Bangladesh. So we have a very high humidity and a very hot climate. So hot and humid climate makes people celebrate rain because we love rain. And there are, if you look through our literature, our songs and poems, it's all filled with celebration of rain. And we celebrate rain even in our architecture as well. So this is one project that I did a long time ago. It was finished in 2001. This also celebrates rain. It's an open court. This image actually shows that, you know, how, I mean, a Bengali hut is actually a primal pavilion. So all you need is a roof on top to actually save you from all the elements, sun and rain. Otherwise, you can keep the whole environment absolutely open as much as possible so that you can take in air and ventilation and enjoy the overall atmosphere. So this project, as you see, it's in a dense city of Dhaka. And so we thought of, you know, when you're in a dense city, how do you deal with this pavilion form? Like, how do you make a pavilion in a dense city like that? So we created a courtyard which looked upwards. So it's a open to sky court. This whole apartment is a very small one. It's about 125 square meters of space. So we created a courtyard which opens to the sky. This is what you see here. And this is the section where you see the volume of the court, which is high because it was on the top floor of a building. And the idea was that this court, this chimney-like court, will take in air. So it really works very well. I mean, there's a chimney effect, what's called, or a stack effect, that draws the air up, hot air up, and there is a draft of air constantly being created through the sides of the building. So if you see, this is the court here, and it sort of opens up to the space. And the sides are open, so all the air is draft of air is coming in through here and going out through that courtyard. And this is a project where we actually also used a lot of, most of the elements that we used are recycled, except for the concrete, of course. The bricks you see are from old houses that are generally torn down in the old part of the city. Because of the dampness, it's quite often not possible for us to keep these buildings. So these buildings are torn down. And these bricks are really beautiful, 150-year-old bricks. So we took those bricks, cleaned them, and we used them as a cladding material. And this is the door to the bathroom, which is made out of brick as well. And the flooring was done with the travertine. Travertine, as you know, is a very porous stone, and we found that with a supplier, which was just cut pieces from another project, lying with them for more than 12 years. So we took that and we created an interesting pattern that I'll show you. This is the kitchen, a hammered copper. So if you see, these are the material of the floor and the benches. We try to keep everything in one material. So you see different size and shapes because these were just cut pieces from another project. So you'll see 1-inch linear pieces. You'll see some which are 4-inch by 4-inch. There are some bigger pieces as well. And yeah, we had a wonderful guy who could do magic, and he did. So he created all these interesting features for us, and that is his home. And we did. We also used this broken porcelain to create a mosaic for the bathrooms. This is the brick that I showed you. So we even cladded the bathroom with brick. You see the wash basin here, and you see the hammered copper. And these are the utensils we generally use for cooking. And so these are the bricklayers from North Bengal. And they do the finest of brickworks. And as I told you earlier, that brick is one of the most important materials for us. And I have used brick in many of my projects, like this one. This is a small house in the outskirts of Dhaka, where, as I said, that pavilion form. And it's not always possible to create that pavilion-like feeling, but I try to keep the spaces as open as possible. So these corner courts are completely open courts, though it keeps the form very intact. And there is a central atrium, and it pushes the air out as well. So this kind of draft of air is always being created through the projects. These are the courts on the corners, and this is the central space through which the air is sort of pushed out. And this is from the top. You see the pavilion form is also here. So this pavilion or this porosity, and this is, you see, this is the cotton fabric, which is kind of generally porous, and cotton is the fabric we use in our tropical hot climate, hot and humid climate. And that porosity I have used in many different ways, this breathability of the facade or the material. And this is one project I did where I took that same impression and created an interior space, including the shelving units of that project, which is a showroom for a cotton fabric factory. A similar kind of a thing for a project which we won as a competition, the French and German embassy in Dhaka. The French and German decided to create an embassy together. So there also we created a central atrium, and then we cut the corners because the embassies do not want any openings on the sides so that people don't see them from outside. And they had a small site, and it had to be stacked floors. So the offices are on the sides, and we have a central courtyard. And this is what the building looked like. So we won first prize for this. Though later on, the project was given to a French architect to build. That happens. And this is also another project I designed. You see that I have a fascination or an affinity towards a very purity of forms, but I try to open them up as much as possible. This was also a small vacation house for a client where I have the glasses here on the edges on this side. If you take a look in this image here, you see that the glass is basically cutting through the sections. And this is another building where also, again, I tried to use this idea of taking in air, draft of air. And this is an apartment building which is in Dhaka, a 12-story building where you have two apartments on two sides, and the core is in the middle. And we have generally, what I learned from here is the southeast wind is bad for you. Southeast wind is the best wind we have. So that's the wind we always try to take in. So if you see, this is our north, which means these edges gives us the best quality of wind, and we take the wind in and then we try to let them out. So there's a draft of air that's been created, and south wind is always the best wind we have. So we try to take in, and also the north light. So this is what the building is. It's also in this crowded city of Dhaka, but at least it gets a... Okay, so this is my grandmother, just to She's my client for the next project. This project was given to me to build a mosque to the outskirts of Dhaka. This is a place where my family have some land, and there was no mosque, so my grandmother thought that would be nice to have a mosque in that location, so she gave a land. And this is the first sort of a prayer that we had in the site under a jackfruit tree, and that's where my grandmother, you can see her. So I was given this site, the plot, and also a very small sum of money. I had to gather the money to build the mosque, and it's not so easy to collect money, so I had to ask from my family members, locals, and everybody to gather some money to build the mosque. So I had really very minimal budget, but I wanted, you don't really get to build some projects like that of some such wonderful spiritual quality. And once you get that, you really tend to become really ambitious to create something beautiful. And you know that Islam, if you go through Islamic architecture, you'll see that it has a rich legacy of wonderful buildings. And one such building is this mosque in Cordoba, in Spain, which I find one of the finest examples of mosques. Or even if you look at some of the mosques during the Ottoman Empire, designed by Sinan, and you see how beautifully light has been taken in. This is not any of Sinan's mosques, this is Hagia Sophia. And if you see that the lights, how the dome is being placed, and the lights from the side, and it sort of glows the whole overall space in the dome, and the way the light is brought in, it's absolutely magical. And light is something I have always had an affinity for, and I like to express light into my design as well. So let me give you a little idea about how mosques are done. It's actually Muslims pray to a certain direction, which is the direction of Kaaba, which is in Saudi Arabia and Mecca. And all mosques are generally either the mosque or the prayer hall is directed towards that direction. So that's an important element when you design a mosque. So if you look at a mosque here, this is a mosque in Iran. You see that this is plan here. You see that the city, this central space is absolutely tuned with the city grid. But the mosque has taken a completely different turn because of the axis or its orientation towards Kaaba. And these are some of the mosques in Bangladesh, all done in brick. And if you see here, I'm showing you four different spiritual spaces in Bangladesh. This is a plan of a monastery during the Buddhist time, which is 1600 years old. This is a plan of a temple, which is from 800 years back. This is a mosque, a nine-dome mosque, which is 600 years old. And this is a more recent kind of spirituality, which is Louis Kahn's parliament building done in 50 years old, but it's also coming from a square formation. So from that, I derived my own plan of the mosque, which is also a squarish in form, and it has a 75 feet by 75 feet square, as the site gave me. And because of the direction, I had to shift the central prayer hall towards a certain direction, which you can see here. And this is the area where the mosque is located, and this is where the mosque is. So this is a growing, also a very growing urban situation where I'm expecting that all these lands will be filled up. So the design had to be done in a way that you do not have any opening on the sides, and this whole idea of taking in air. And since it's a very low budget project, I also have to keep in mind that I cannot install air conditioning, so it has to be naturally ventilated, and the minimum of and since mosques do not get much funding, it had to be done in a way that it should be absolutely low maintenance project. So this is the plan, final plan. You see that the walls are very porous on all sides as much as possible so that I can make it a breathing wall. And these edges, you see here the circular part on four corners, these are all open to sky courts that actually ventilates the air out, creates a draft. And this is what you see if you generate three-dimensional image. These are the porous walls, and these edges are all made out of brick, completely load-bearing structure, no concrete, because concrete is expensive, brick is cheaper for us to build, since labor is cheap in Bangladesh. So we created this whole area with brick, and only the central space, which is the prayer hall, was done in concrete because I wanted a space which was column-free. So this is what the mosque looked like now. I've tried to keep to that idea of the mosque that was from Bengal, and it's not going completely a radical approach, but keeping a continuity to the language that was developed in this land. And you see already there's a building coming up, and I'm expecting there will be other buildings coming up on the side. So at one point you won't see the mosque anymore, maybe on the from the roadside. So then you need to have space or the walls done in a way that it breathes by itself. So that's the more the brick part. That's the corner of the prayer hall through which the light goes in. This is how the light is falling into the space. So that's the edge of the sides. And the prayer hall, as I showed you, is basically a pavilion. And that's it. It has no glass, nothing on the sides. So it just works as a pavilion, and the breathing walls actually let the air in. So this is absolutely just a space, simple space, and light from different sources and sides. And you know, when you design a space of spirituality, you know, it's about turning the physical into metaphysical. It's about, you know, creating a connection with eternity, or, you know, infinite. So light, I think, is an important element that really brings that, or gives that to the very space. So that's what I tried to adapt to with the minimum or the whatever budget I was given. And this floor, Peter was mentioning earlier, this is a cast-in situ terrazzo, which we did with glass strips in the middle and with stone dust. I mean, we didn't have the money to buy stone, so we took stone dust from the where they cut the stones. So when they cut the stone, there is some dust that are accumulated, and these dusts have no use, actually. They don't use it. They just either throw it away or give it away to people. So we took the sack of stone dusts, and we used white cement and created this whole floor out of that. And the circular dots of light, as you see, falling on the floor actually adds to that whole space. That's the direction of Mecca, the light that's coming through. So that's all I have today for you, three projects that I wanted to show you more. Thank you.